Whether it was in London or in Paris, wherever it was, means they couldn't care less about the local peoples of these places. Maybe you combine together some groups which do not live in peace. Maybe you cut a group in the middle, but they couldn't care less. Let them kill each other, and the more the better. This is more or less the colonialism, how it treated the Middle East, as it treated Africa and other places in the world. Not only this, the borders were marked according to the interests of the colonialists. Just to give you an example, Sinai, which is this, was annexed to Egypt. Although Sinai is part of Asia, and Egypt is part of Africa, and since the digging of the Suez Canal, you cannot anymore walk from side to side with dry shoes. Okay? So geographically, there's no reason why to annex Sinai, which is part of Asia, to Egypt, which is part of Africa. Not only this, in the population. Population of Egypt are peasants, and they speak Arabic in the Egyptian dialect. While those who live in Sinai are Bedouins, nomads, not people who have any agricultural background, and they speak a Saudi dialect. They cannot even correspond with each other, because they don't understand each other. So how come Sinai became part of Egypt? Because the British, when they were there, they wanted, along the 19th century, to have a buffer zone between the Ottoman Empire, which was here until the First World War, and the British ships, which sailed from Britain all the way to the east to India. So they needed Sinai as a buffer zone to protect the ships from the bullets or the cannons of the Ottomans. So they drew a line here, more or less parallel to the Suez Canal, so the Ottomans cannot touch those ships even with a long stick. Okay? And Egypt, until this very day, is bleeding because of the struggle between the Bedouins of Sinai and the Egyptian government, until this very day, only because of the British interests of the 19th century. Okay? Another good example, or bad example, is the Kurdish district of Iraq, which was meant to be part of Turkey. But the British occupied it after the ceasefire of the First World War, only because of the oil which was found between Mosul and Kirkuk in the Kurdish area. So they occupied it from Turkey, and they marked the borders 100 kilometers around the oil field. So the Turks, the Iranians, and the Syrians cannot touch the oil even with a long stick. Okay? The same logic, the same interests. Here is shipping. There is the oil, which marked the borders of the Middle East. And actually, the annexation of the Kurdish district to Iraq is the source of oil even in Iraq, because as we all remember, during the 20th century, since Iraq was established like 90 years ago, there was a civil war between the Arab government and the Kurdish minority. You remember names like Mullah Mustafa Barazani and Jalal Talabani, all those who led this rebellion. And everything is only because the British greed to the oil of the Kurdish district. So, borders were marked either arbitrarily or according to the interests of the colonialists. This is why the borders, which are actually the definitions of the states, are viewed in many cases as illegitimate by the local people who live in those countries. This is why they challenge the borders. As you know, the Islamic State actually erased the border between Iran and Syria because they consider these borders as illegitimate because they were torn by the colonialists and only their own interests. The question is, if we look to the culture of the Middle East, what can we say about this? Here, again, we have to resort to geography, because this is actually the real map of the Middle East. This is Morocco, this is Algeria, this is Tunisia here, Libya, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Yemen, Oman, Emirates, Iraq here, Syria here, Lebanon here and Israel is here. And you can very easily see there's a picture from the space. The whole thing is a desert. Dry, arid area. And if you want to survive in such an area, you need a source of water. Otherwise, you are dead. And if you find a spring, or you dig a well, or a ditch, you have to protect it. Because there are others in the desert who would like also to drink, and they need also. So, for this, you have to be strong in order to protect your source of water. And the strongest group of people are the family, the father and the sons. And after a generation, it's the cousins. After another generation, the second cousins. And the third cousins. So what do we have? A tribe. This is why tribe, to live in a tribe, to live as a tribe, is essential in this area. Otherwise, you are weak. Otherwise, you cannot defend your source of water. And otherwise, you'll be chased out by other groups which are more consolidated than you are. This is why the family, or the extended family, or the clan, or the tribe, the name doesn't mean much. I'm talking about the essence. It is actually the cornerstone of the societies in most parts of the Middle East. And the clan, or to live in a clan, is something which people in America and in Israel and in Europe, Australia, New Zealand, people do not have a clue what it means. First of all, it means that everybody is related to everybody else. Just imagine that everybody in this room are all either brothers or cousins or second cousins. Okay? Secondly, this group must have armed militia. And they don't mess with them. Because in that kind of area, the one who shoots the second doesn't shoot anymore. You know why? Because he's dead already. Okay, you cannot allow yourself to be nice when the other part, when the other party is violent, because you will lose. So you have to shoot first. This way, by the way, violence is such an immediate tool to lose, to use in feuds and struggles all over this area. You don't marry your daughter to anybody who is from outside of the clan, because the others are the enemies, because they want to take our source of water. And you never give your daughter to somebody whom you hate, and she will be abused, she will not be accepted there. So you marry her to the cousin. To have a cousin means the son of your brother. Because you are in control, you make sure that she is nicely treated, and if he abuses your daughter, you will talk to his father, means to your brother, hey, say something to your son, you will treat my daughter better. Okay, so she remains in control. In the tribe has rules, and the rules of the tribe are much more important, much more significant than any other rule, including the rule of the state, which later came, and even the rules of the religion, Islam. What do I mean? And one of the rules of tribe is if they killed one of us, so we will kill one of them in order to preserve or to keep the balance of power between both tribes. Now, who will we kill? Preferably the killer. But if you run away, or we don't know who killed our men, so we will kill one of their khams, one of his khams. Khams means five, means we go to his father, grandfather, great-grandfather, and the father of the great-grandfather, and all the descendants, the males, descendants of the father of his great-grandfather, are candidates to be killed as a revenge. Even if it is a two-year-old boy who is crawling on the floor. Why? Because this is the law. This is against any state law. Because if there is a logic, catch the killer and kill him. This is some kind of logic. But here, what is this two-year toddler did to you? He doesn't even know the killer. Why should he be killed as a revenge? But this is the tribe law. Or it's also against Islam. There's no way to kill a cousin or fifth cousin of a killer. Catch the killer, put him in court, bring witnesses, and if he comes out guilty, kill him. If this is the remedy. Okay, this is some kind of logic. It's according to Islam. So the tribal laws are both against the state law and against Islam. Another good example is, let's say you have a 20-year-old daughter, and she fools around too much with boys. So she brings shame on the clan and on the family. So what would be her punishment? As I say in Arabic, rasl al-ar means washing the shame by her blood, which will come out from her neck when she will be slaughtered. Okay? This is a standard punishment. Again, it's against any state law, because a girl of 20, according to any modern state, has the freedom to do whatever she likes with whoever she likes, because she's a daughter. And even according to Islam, you cannot do it arbitrarily. You have to bring four witnesses who are men, males, who are praying, means religious, who saw her together, means they were together seeing her fooling around with somebody. A lady usually, when she fools around with boys, she doesn't bring four men to watch her. All males, normal, and praying. Okay? So, you cannot even bring it to court because there are no witnesses. How can you kill her? But we see that honor killing in the Islamic world is on left, right, and center. And all those girls went to court, and they were in court. Forget it. Okay, so this means that the tribal law is much more powerful than the religious law, because there is no way to even to tear a hair out of the head of this young lady according to Islam if you don't put her in court and bring witnesses and so forth. This is essential. So the tribal culture, tribal laws are against the state laws and against Islam. These laws are existing way before Islam came to the world, because Islam is only 14th centuries, while these laws are documented millennia before Islam came to the world. So, definitely the culture of the tribe is something which is much more powerful than the culture of Islam and the culture of course, this newly established state. And a tribe has its leadership, and it's a real leadership, legitimate leadership, and are not elected because they are natural leaders, viewed as leaders by everybody, and according to Islam, according to the tribal law, a leader, means a sheikh, as they call it, he will eat the last if there is a shortage of food. He will drink the last if there is a shortage of water, because he is responsible, unlike politicians in all kinds of democratic states, who are more responsible mainly for the bank account and their friends and allies. Okay? But in those times, the leadership, the shuyukh, means the leaders, are really responsible, because if he eats before the last one ate, it's a shame, it's a haib. And shameful things are the last things which these people allow themselves to do, because your honor is above everything. You will sacrifice your life in order to keep your honor rather than living as somebody with humiliation. So this is, I would say, in a nutshell, about what it is to live as a tribe. I, Bar Ilan, I have a seminar which takes a whole year about tribalism, what it means to live in a tribe, or what it means that you have tribal society. And this is actually essential to this environment. There is no way, there is no other way how to live in this area. And as a result, states like Iraq look like this. This is the real map of Iraq. And these are, this mosaic are the tribes of Iraq. I can give you the name of all of them. I have the list. Okay. Now, they all live in the eastern part of the state because of the water. Because this is more or less the line of the Euphrates. This is the Tigris. They unite here where the 19 is written. And they go down together to the Persian Gulf as a united river named Shatt al-Arab. And between the rivers, there are Iraq. And this is where the name of the country came from. Iraq means in Arabic, veins, means canals of water, which combine the two rivers, the Euphrates in the west and the Tigris in the east, and actually equate the level of the water between these two rivers. So we can live either near the Euphrates or near the Tigris or near those canals, because you have constant flow of water, so we can drink, because Iraq has no rains. Or definitely not regular rains, which you can count. So you need access to the water, otherwise you will try to this way through the generations, those tribes which are not nomads, they don't wander in the space because water comes to them. They have borders, very strict borders. They don't move the borders, and whoever breaches those borders actually sacrifices himself because the others will treat him according to what he's doing. So this is, and these tribes were there way before Islam. Some of them are documented 200, 300 years before Islam came to the world. And they are loyal to the tribe, much more than they are loyal to anything else. But this is not the only problem in Iraq. As we mentioned, this is that these are Kurdish tribes. Most of those in the south are Arabs. These are Turkmens, speak Turkish, and nobody marries them because they are Turkish. So they remain what they were. And these are Persians. They speak Persian, who wander to the west and settled in this country. So Iraq is actually a country with four major ethnic groups, Kurds, Arabs, Turkmens and Persians, divided to 70-something tribes. Most of them are Muslims, but some of them Christians, some of them Yazidis, especially here in 72. Those who are, the men are slaughtered and the girls are being sold to slavery by the Islamic State. Some of them are Zoroastrians, some of them from the religious point of view. Some of them are Baha'is, some of them are Sabais and Mandais and Shumbaks. And there are also in Iraq some Jews, especially in the cities, and some Druze who ran away from Syria, and Alawis as well. So all the 10 religions of the Middle East, 10 religions, have representation in Iraq. Some of them are viewed by Muslims as infidels, those who do not have the right to live. And this is another division, another axis of fragmentation. And some of those religions are divided to sects, because the Muslims are divided between Sunnah and Shia and Salafis and Sufis and all kinds of others. And the Christians, when they were there, were 8 denominations. 6 ran away altogether. The last 2 are on the run because they are abused by the others. And the Mandais also are divided to some extent. So Iraq actually suffers from all 4 excess of fragmentation which exists in the Middle East. The ethnic one, Arabs, Kurds, Turkmens and Persians. The tribal one, which is this map. The religious one, Muslims, Christians, and so forth. And the sectarian one, Sunnah, Shia, and denominations. And when the British drew the borders of Iraq some 90 years ago, they hoped that with the time, the fact that they have one state, one flag, one national anthem, one government, one ministry of health, and one ministry of education, and one army, and one police, they will all abandon their traditional loyalties to the tribe, to the ethnic group, to the religious and the sectarian group, will all define themselves as Iraqis by the identity card, will all sit around one fire and sing Kumbaya together. It didn't happen. It doesn't happen. And according to what we see on the ground, it will never happen. Why? What? This country shows, shows that everybody can live without ideas. People who came from all over the world. Made a nation. Why cannot this happen in Iraq or in other countries in the Middle East? What is the difference? And this is when people start not to understand. This nation was built by individuals who came as individuals from wherever they came. South America, Africa, Asia, East Europe, West Europe. They came as individuals or maybe nuclear families, means father, mother and their children, in order to become Americans. And in most cases, they left, to a degree, large degree, the cultures which they came from. And they came to be Americans. Maybe not the first generation, but the second generation which goes to public schools, not to mention the third generation, become Americans. Their language is already English, without any foreign accent, children, the grandchildren definitely, and the grandchildren not always know where the grandfather or the grandmother came from. Because so part of the issue. We are all Americans. Once you get your papers, you become American. So the melting pot works. I know, not fully, not 100% of success. We do have some enclaves of old cultures, but definitely America is a son of success, if you see what happens here. These societies never went through a process of fragmentation to individuals, because those tribes are still living there as tribes. They view the other as the enemy. They live in their area, and their school system and their economy, everything is within us. Why should we feel a brothers and sisters with the others? What happened? Okay, so since they keep living in groups of dozens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of people, which do not mingle into each other, don't get married with each other, they don't live together, so this process of creating a nation out of individuals never happened in Iraq. This is why people continue to be loyal to those traditional frameworks, whether it's tribe, ethnic, religious, or sectarian groups. Syria is no different from Iraq. Syria looks the same, more or less, but in Syria, they have another problem, because in Iraq, just to compare, Saddam Hussein, he was at least the Muslim. Although he was Sunni, controlling majority of Shia, but at least he was a Muslim. In Syria, the picture is much more complicated, because the Assad regime are not considered to be Muslims. Why? In Israel, we have an Alawi, the sect of Assad. We have an Alawi village. And one day, a few years ago, I went to see what can be seen in this village with a camera. And I knew where I was going. And I went to the sanctuary of the village. Means the, it's not a temple, the sanctuary of the, and look at how it looks like. There's something which, if Muslim sees it, isn't this. This is the sanctuary of the Alawis in the center of Raja, the only Alawi village in Israel. Raja, in the western part of the Hermon mountain, to the north from Dan and Daphna. Now look at this. This column is topped by two pigeons. The upper one resembles Ali bin Abi Talib, the fourth caliph in Islam. He is viewed by the Alawis as the incarnation of Allah in the body of Ali. More or less, the Eastern Christian belief that Jesus Christ was an incarnation of God. The lower one is Muhammad, resembles Muhammad. And Ali is above Muhammad. And they bow to this statue. Here, behind the white gate, behind this white element, you can see a vitrine, this box. This is the basis, this is one corner, this is another corner, this is glass, another piece of glass. And inside it, there is a statue of Mother Mary, like 40 centimeters, and they revere her as a goddess. As a goddess. And they bow to her as well. Now, when a Muslim sees such a thing, he gets the goosebumps. Because this is a sheer idol worshipping. Not with brackets, real idol worshippers. Those always are. And according to Islam, not radical Islam, Islam, idol worshipper, her has the choice between abandoning his idol worshipping and embracing Islam, or being shot by head. Why? Because he worships idols. So those Alawis who control Syria, not only they don't have the right to control its state because they are a minority, there is a big question if they have at all the right to live being idol worshippers. And this is the problem in Syria. Not the struggle for the government. It's a struggle for the connection between their heads and shoulders. Because they know exactly what will happen to this connection if they fall into the hands of the Islamists. So this is a struggle in Syria. This is why it's such a vicious struggle. Because it's a struggle on the Hussein, on everything. Because if they lose a father, they lose their lives away. So this is why violence in Syria is way much bigger than the violence in Egypt, for example, as we saw at the beginning of the so-called Arab Spring. So those who do not know these facts and do not understand that how people think in that area do not get it. Why is so? Why is this area so violent? And what are the struggles about? About religion, about sectarianism like in Iraq, and about tribalism as it is in Libya, because Libya also is a tribal state. And in Libya, even the tribalism there is much worse than in many other places. This is a map of like 10% of Libya. The Tripoli area. This is the Tripoli. And all these are the tribes. Now you can see that these tribes do not have borders, only names, because they are nomads. They are wandering in the space. Why? Because when they exhaust the source of water which they dig, they move to another place and they dig again in order to find some other puddle under the surface. Okay? So, since they are nomads, they don't have borders. But since those sources of water which they can find in the Sahara are have much less water, the tribes have to divide when they are still small. In Iraq, they can be big tribes because they have constant flow of water if the Turks do not close the rivers with dams. But they can live and multiply and remain the same place, consolidated. While in Libya, they cannot live together because when the tribe becomes too big, the source of water is not enough. It has to be divided. So some of them move. So this is why these tribes are so many tribes and much smaller. Now, the smaller a tribe is, the more vicious it must be in order to project danger, so the big ones will not try to get rid of them. So the smaller you are, the more cruel you are, the more vicious you are. One of the smallest tribes in Libya were the tribe of Gaddafi. Now Gaddafi is an adjective of the name of the tribe. The real name of the tribe is Kazaf Eddam. Kazaf Eddam in Arabic means the one who sheds blood. And according to all the stories, in Libya, they gained their name for a reason. Okay, they were vicious, this tribe, and that's how we took the country over in 1969 and controlled it as a vicious, bloodthirsty dictator. Okay, this is how it worked for 42 years until it was kicked out in 2011. So this is actually, I would say, in a nutshell, the culture of the Middle East. Desert, tribalism, desert which causes tribalism, tribalism which has its roles, and cruelty, as we see, unfortunately, in these countries. However, there are some countries which are normal countries in the Middle East. I mean, the Emirates in the Gulf, Kuwait, Qatar, and the United Arab Emirates, seven Emirates, Dubai, Ras Al Khaimah, Abu Dhabi, Sharjah, Umm Ajman, all those who never hear about them. Altogether nine Emirates, and I exclude Bahrain. All these nine states are viewed as legitimate, unlike Syria, Iraq, and many others, and Libya, of course. They are viewed as states as legitimate, and the regime also is viewed as legitimate. Why? Because every one of them is one single tribe. Al-Sabah in Kuwait. Al means tribe in Arabic. It is a derivative of the word Ahl in Arabic, which is well, the people, but also Ohel, it's in Hebrew, means the tent. So since they all live in one tent, metaphorical tent, they are called Al-Sabah. Sabah is the name. I don't talk about the foreign business people who come to Kuwait to make money. And I don't talk about those who come from Bangladesh to work in construction. I'm talking about the citizens of Kuwait are, in most cases, parts or members of one big tribe, which is Al-Sabah. Qatar the same as one significant tribe, which is Al-Thani. Abu Dhabi, which is here, is another tribe. is Al Nihyan. Okay? And every one of them is another Al. So their society is homogeneous, one major tribe. So nobody shakes the boat, nobody fights, because we live with ourselves. And the leadership are the same families who were the leaders 200 years ago when they were riding camels in the desert. Okay? Today they are riding golden Lamborghinis. What's the difference? The camel is 4x4 and the Lamborghini is 4x4. But the speed, this is not difference. Okay? So the families who were the leaders then are the leaders today. So the leadership is legitimate, the state is legitimate, and the society is functioning. Because homogeneous society is stable, nobody fights anyone, and they have tribal courts in order to deal with every dispute which people could have, and whoever doesn't obey the court is being punished by the tribe, and everybody obeys because it's our people. So the political arena is functioning and without elections. They don't need elections. Elections you need when you have politicians who compete with each other. They don't have politicians, they have real leaders who take responsibility, real responsibility. Okay? So they don't have any alternative, those leaders. So they are there forever. And if somebody dies, his son will replace him if he is a good leader. If not, he will be somebody else from the family. Okay, this is how it works. Much, much more fitting the culture. And on the stability of the political arena, you can build skyscrapers with helicopter beds on them, because the tenants are very rich, and when they go to the private jet, they don't want to stand in red light, so they take the house helicopter. Okay, so they have money, even if they have no oil, like in Dubai. Dubai has no oil. Maybe 1% of their GDP is based on oil and or gas. 99% is business. Free trade zones, attractions for tourists, and lucrative housing, which they sell to the rich people of the world. And Dubai is so rich, and they're so good in business, that they actually are running the harbors of the United States of America, because they're good in business. So even without oil, they're a flourishing country. While Iraq, fragmented as it is, on tribal axis, ethnic axis, religious and sectarian axis, the society is fragmented, the political arena cannot function, because when two tribes are fighting in the streets, the representatives in the parliament are fist fighting with each other, in the parliament. But this is good, because in Libya, they shoot at each other with machine guns inside the parliament. Imagine, machine guns in the rebel house, okay? This is what happens in Libya. So the political arena cannot function in such societies. So the economy, in spite of the oil, which is much in Iraq and Libya and Yemen and others, with oil, there are failing states. Dubai, without the oil, is a successful state. Means not the oil is the element of how to become rich. Society, if you are homogeneous, you will be rich. If you are heterogeneous, you will be victim of constant feuds and fights in the society. And this is actually, I would say, an introductory to the history of the Middle East of the 20th century. Everything else is what happened here, what happened there, and the details of these principles. And these are the principles. Just to show you, Yemen, another tribal society is this. These are the tribes of Yemen. Everyone has the name of it. And actually, especially this area, the tribes actually are, the division is actually the landscape of the country. Because every mountain is a tribe. Because they live on the top of the mountain, they build a wall around it, and you can reach the place only on a donkey. Not even with horse. Because the horses, you know, is a very stupid animal. Because the ratio of brains versus body is a third compared to the ratio of brains versus body at the donkeys. Yes, the donkeys has 3 times as big brains as the horse has. A donkey knows if he passes some place, he knows where not to step, even with his back feet, which are like more than a meter apart from his eyes. He remembers exactly. The horse doesn't know it. So a horse will fall where a donkey knows how not to fall. So this is why only a donkey can take you up to these tribes who live on the tip of the mountains. So this is actually why they don't mingle with each other, and there is no Yemenite nation. Now tribes who never became one nation, and this is why it is so easy, because of the cracks between all those parts of the society, for Saudi Arabia and Iran today to recruit all kinds of parts of the society and use them against each other as some kind of mercenaries for the Iranians on one side and the Saudi on the other side. If there wasn't a Yemenite nation, they would have something in common and they would not fight each other as they do today as messengers or mercenaries of others like the Saudis and the Iranians. The same thing in Syria. If the Syrians had some kind of awareness of together, they wouldn't fight each other as they do. The same thing in Iraq, the same thing in Libya. So this is what I keep claiming. For years, and people were accusing me that I'm racist. No, there is no Iraqi nation. There is no Syrian nation. They all have the same identity card. In many ways, identity card doesn't make the identity. Your identity is much more connected to the tribe rather than to the card, which is given to you by the state as it is in this country. And another example of fragmentation is actually Afghanistan. And forgive me for the fact that this map is in Arabic, it's in Hebrew, but the different colors are actually different ethnic groups. And these are all in Afghanistan. Kyrgyzis, Turkmens, Nuristanis, Pamiris, Pashtunis, Tajikis, Hazaris, Uzbekis, Aymakis, Baluchis, and this is not the end of the list. Okay? Not even one is called Afghani. Afghanistan is an artificial name which was given to them by the British, who drew the lines of Afghanistan with the Russians some 160 years ago, hoping that with the years they will become one nation. They cannot even correspond with each other because they speak different languages, different mindset, different habits, different traditions, different everything. And the Hazaris are Shia, while all the others are Sunnah. Another problem. Okay? So there is no Afghani nation. There are Afghani groups or ethnic groups, but not the name. We're not one consolidated nation. And this is the source of all evil in Afghanistan. Because of the fragmentation, there's always struggles between all those groups. So other powers have to come in. The Russians and the Soviet Union later, and the British and the Americans, and everyone goes to Afghanistan in order to find some kind of solution between those. Why didn't the world divide this country to ethnic states? Just like what happened with the Soviet Union, which was divided in the end of the 80s, the beginning of the 90s, to ethnic states. Kyrgyzstan stand for the Kyrgyzs, Uzbekistan for the Uzbeks, Armenia for the Armenians, Belarus, Ukraine, Estonia, Latvia, okay, all these republics which became states are in most cases normal nation states, because the one is a majority of one nation. Ukraine continues to be a mayhem because in Ukraine there are two groups, Russians and Ukrainians. So this actually shows that whenever you have multiple ethnicities together, they tend to fall apart. Not in a war like in Yugoslavia. Yugoslavia was in a war. Czechoslovakia fell apart in our state. Okay? A state for the Czechs, the first state for the Slovaks. And Yugoslavia also was divided, the state for the Serbs and the Croats and the Montenegros. Okay? Because Yugoslavia formerly was a dictatorship because it was a conglomerate of ethnic groups which never became one consolidated nation. So why not divide Afghanistan according to what happened in Soviet Union, Yugoslavia, Czechoslovakia? Why should we all be all forced to live together now, to die together, rather than live as normal states, divided from each other? Let everyone have his own state and leave the others alone. But now, the world continue to resuscitate this dead body politic named Afghanistan and Iraq and Syria and Libya and Yemen and all the others. It is totally useless what happens in those countries. And unfortunately, the world doesn't understand. Maybe now the new administration will maybe understand the source of all evil in the Middle East, which was the borders, the artificial borders, which were marked by the colonialism, and maybe rethink all those artificial borders and try to work with the local peoples in these places in order to create homogeneous states rather than the artificial states, which are totally dysfunctional, as we see in the recent years very clearly. This is the message. This is maybe to understand the culture of the Middle East, which is totally different compared to the culture of this country. And hopefully, someday will come, and when a courageous American administration will come and name the problem, will put the hand on the problem and understand the problem, maybe this will open a new future for the Middle East, which will be much more peaceful and with some kind of a hope. Israel is just like this country. Israel is a country of immigrants. My parents came from Poland. Their neighbors came from Yemen. Individuals. So with individuals, you can work like a melting pot in order to create a new mindset. You cannot do it when groups come and stand together and they don't mingle with each other. The one emirate which does it is Qatar. Qatar is a state which was re-educated by one man, Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi, who ran away, Muslim Brotherhood leader, who ran away from Egypt in order to keep his head connected to his shoulders, and settled in Qatar, and re-educated the Qataris to support the Muslim Brotherhood, Hamas, and all the other Muslim Brotherhood derivatives all over the world. Qatar is a unique case. Only because they didn't pay any price for this. If the world told them, hey guys, stop it, otherwise they would stop it because they want to survive. But the world knew exactly what Qatar is doing. The world knew exactly that Qatar is sending money to the Islamic State, for example, for Hamas. The biggest supporter of Hamas is Qatar and many other Muslim Brotherhood organizations, including here. But the world stood idly, maybe because Qatar brought people as well, politicians, media people, and academicians. And this is the problem. Money talks. And when you have much money, as much money talks. You think like an American. Because New Jersey and New York and Oklahoma and North Carolina are not sovereign. They have one, the union is actually the sovereign. Okay, sovereignty. New York is not sovereignty. So you think like in logic that yes, we have counties, but we need one umbrella above them, which is Washington DC and the government. Okay? This is how you think. This is thinking like an American. It doesn't work in the Middle East. You know, trying to solve the problems of the Middle East by thinking like an American is just like to fix your Chevrolet in a garage of Harley Davidson. It's a different culture, different spare parts, different training, different everything, different computer, different everything. You cannot, okay, if you understand that your Chevrolet needs a garage of Chevrolet, while Harley Davidson can very well take care of Harley Davidson's, okay, now you can understand that America is good for America, while the Middle East culture has to be dealt with by using Middle Eastern tools like tribal entity. And they are much, much more peaceful and fitting the culture of the Middle East rather than democracy, which is a world which was created for Westerners who experienced totally different history and culture. Let them decide. Once you merge them together, they fight. Once you divide them, they cooperate. They work according to the logic of high fences make good neighbors. You know why? If we have two neighboring houses and we decided not to make a fence, so we can all use the same lawn, okay? My dog is chasing your cats. Your son is kicking his football into my windows and we are bad neighbors because of the dog and the cats and the football. Once we have a wall, my dog is in my part, your cats are sunbathing peacefully, And your son is kicking his football into your windows and not mine. So we are good neighbors. Okay, defense actually is the element which makes us good neighbors. And we can cooperate against the municipality which tries to do something which we, both of us, do like. Okay, that's how it works.
Interpretation.
This needed another lecture about the things about in order to answer you, and Sarah will have to bring me again for this only. By the way, Sarah wrote a magnificent book about Saudi Arabia. I highly recommend this book. However, what happens is that this border of between Yemen and Saudi Arabia was drawn on the mountains. Some tribes which are here are mountain culture. They are not nomads. They live on the mountain tops, just like Yemen. Saudi Arabia is different culture. This is a culture of nomads and people who live in the plainlands, which is totally different from any point of view. Ibn Saud, when he forged the kingdom, he was one tribe. But how did he make such a big country? He went to other tribes, in the north and in the center, towards the south, who share with him the same culture, and he came to them with his brothers, means fighters, with long swords and camels, and he came to the head of the tribe, the local tribe, and sat with him and said, look, you have the choice between joining my union, or my brothers will take care of you. So he looked out, saw those with the sword, so he decided, now, what do you mean by joining me? You give me your daughter as a wife. Okay, so by marriage, he merged many tribes. And he had many, many wives. Nobody knows who were the four full rights wives and who were the concubines, which a man can have according to Islam. He never disclosed who is what. My brother. This is how he made this coalition of tribes. 2/3 of the population did not join it. The Shia in the east, where the oil is, because a Shia will never give his daughter to a Sunni, because Shia view the Sunnah as najis, means impure. So he'll never give his daughter to a Sunni. And the tribes in the south, because the tribes in the south are culture of the mountain. And in addition, they are, because of genetic characteristics, they are taller by head compared to those in the plainlands. And there was not even one Arab who will give his tall daughter to a man who is shorter than her. Matter of culture. Okay? So, these tribes also did not join the union of the tribes. However, in order to draw them to be close to us and to be loyal to us, they gave them business. So, Bin Laden, who is from the southern part, actually became the biggest, not the of the family, became the biggest contractor of Saudi Arabia. Let them have money instead of being part of the family. And as you might remember, in the 80s, they had a minister of oil, Abdesaki Yamani, from that area as well. And minister of oil definitely can take care of his tribesmen. Okay, so this is how they try to incorporate those tribes later, not by marriage, but by business. It works in most cases. Bin Laden didn't work. He took the money and became a terrorist against the Saudis. I will repeat the same lecture.
Yeah.
And I show them where the problems come from.
The actions. I know the
actions divide the states to homogeneous units. There's a question. Especially when it comes to the Palestinian problem. Because since there is no Syrian nation and no Iraqi nation and no Libyan nation, I have big doubts if there is a Palestinian nation, because there are also tribes which never became named. This is why, by the way, the divide between Hamas and the Fatah, between Gaza and the West Bank, is actually based on culture, because the culture of Gaza is different, because most people in Gaza speak in Bedouin language, Bedouin Arabic, while the people in the West Bank, or Judea and Samaria, speak in different Syrian derivative of the Syrian dialect, which is called the Palestinian dialect. So, the different minds, different culture, different everything.
In Iraq, they have been talking about partition for quite some time, right? In Iraq, the courts and the...
Those who understand the problems of Iraq talk about partition. Those who do not talk about keeping Iraq consolidated. And this is the difference. Well, what happened in Europe roughly is the migration from the village to the city, mainly because of the Industrial Revolution during the 17th, 18th to the 19th century. So many, most of the people actually moved from the villages where they were living as clans to the cities where they live as individuals. So when you have individuals living in Paris and in London and all these cities, you can sell the idea of nationalism because we all speak French, we all speak Flemish, whatever language we speak. So you can build an alternative idea of nationalism. This one, nationalism can flourish. In these states, what, Iraqi nationalism? What is the content of Iraqi nationalism when people are still loyal to different frameworks? Because still people live in frameworks which prevents the nationalism from replacing the traditional loyalties. It can happen in a state like Syria, because Syria today went through atrocities which actually broke the society to pieces, to individuals, refugees, unfortunately. But I have no idea. I wrote my PhD about Syria. I know some things about this country. Today, I know nothing. I'm not trying to be funny, because everything which I knew shattered to pieces. So this whole country, if at all, people will come back to Syria, I don't see where to, because cities are destroyed totally. If they come back, and if the world, I don't know with which money, you know, Syria needs so much money in order to be rebuilt. I don't see the reserves of money neither here nor in Europe. So I don't really see how Syria is rebuilt to be a place where people can come to. Okay, but if theoretically all the Syrians who are dispersed all over the world come back to Syria, maybe then you can see a new nation emerges, because all those clans were broken to pieces and dispersed, although I have high doubts. Two countries went to fragmentation, which is Egypt and Tunisia. Egypt, because of the high dam, the Aswan Dam, which actually dried up the whole country, and many millions moved to the cities because they didn't have any more water by the floods, which were coming twice a year from the rains in Ethiopia. So since the dam stopped the regime of twice a year floods all over Egypt, so people emigrate because they don't have any more water and fertilizers, because otherwise they cannot grow anything. So they moved to the cities. So one brother went to Cairo, his brother went to Alexandria, another one went to Kumoshim, another one went to Beirut, another one to Europe and to America. So the society in Egypt actually became individual societies. So now you can sell them the idea of nationalism. And definitely in Egypt, the sense of nationalism is much stronger than in Iraq, Syria, and other tribal societies. This is why, by the way, the Arab Spring, when it's erupted in Egypt in January 2011, Mubarak held it for less than 3 weeks until he was kicked out by Tantawi. In Syria, where Assad has a whole time behind him, he still kills his people for more than 6 years. It's the difference. Mubarak didn't have a tribe behind him. All he had is 2 sons and a wife. That's all. And the politicians abandoned him once they understood that he's weak. The same thing in Tunisia. Tunisia also went through a process of immigration from the village to the city because of deliberate neglect, which two presidents, Bourguiba and Ben Ali, altogether some 50 years of neglect of the rural areas. Everything which they invested were in the cities. Universities, infrastructure, industry, communications, roads, theaters, everything was in the cities. So those youngsters, when they reached the age of 18, 19, 20, boys and girls alike, when they saw in the villages that there is no future in this place, they took the carry-on and they went to the city. So one went to one city, another one to another city, one went to France, and another went to America. So this also in Tunisia, the society actually moved to the cities as individuals. That's why in Tunisia you can see much more developed political life, parties, ideologies, all these things. And this you can do when you fragment the society and you bring it from the village to the city. Now, in Syria, unfortunately, it happens because of a war, bloody war. In Tunisia and Egypt, it came because of neglect in Tunisia, and the atrocity named the Aswan Dam in Egypt. And the price is high. because when families are fragmented, the individuals, it takes that time, long time, until they develop new set of values, new rules of how to behave. This is why in Egypt, for example, sexual harassment in the cities are tremendous, because those boys feel that they can do whatever they like, because there is no time to watch them. Because in any tribal society, the tribe watches over the individual, you better behave, otherwise you have a problem with everybody. So in tribal societies, men behave, because there is the big brother, it's a big tribe overlooking them. While individual societies, like in the Egyptian city, boys feel free to do whatever they like. Just Google sexual harassment in Cairo, you'll find tremendous number of clips how men, young men, behave in very, very big manner because of this. Because there is no tribe to watch over them and to make sure that they behave nicely. Lebanon actually is an experiment made on human beings without the Helsinki committee, which is in every hospital. Okay? They tried, means the French, when they established Lebanon in the 30s, to forge an estate in which not the individual is the player, is the citizen, but the group, the Christian group, the Alawi group, the Druze, the Shi'i, and the Sunni. They are the players. Means to take the sectarian and the religious divide and to make it the name of the game. It works for a while, until demography changed the balance. Today the Shia are the biggest community, and they demand the right of, or the rights of a majority. While the Christians, who were once allegedly the majority, still stick to the all the merits which were given to them by the constitution. So today you see a struggle between the Shia and the Christians. When the French established this state like 80 years ago, they didn't foresee the changes of the population. This is why I think at the end of the day, Lebanon will fall into the hands of the Shia. Only because today they are like half of the population, while all the other communities, the Sunna and the Christians and the Druze and the Alawis, are more or less half. Together, combined, they are half. So the Shia feel that the country belongs to them, and they are most powerful because of Hezbollah. And today they control the country without declaring. So Lebanon actually is another Shi'i state run by Iran, who supports the Hezbollah, under the mask of a democratic state. After you heard what you heard, is there a way to keep Iraq stabilized?
I'm asking you.
No way. If the condition is to have 30,000 American troops, means that initially this country is not stabilized. Only by force, which comes from the outside. There's no way how to keep the state. Forever? Would it be Americans? And don't forget that there is a price in blood and money. 4,000 American soldiers were sacrificed on the Iraqi altar. How many wounded? 20,000? 30,000? Both in the body and in the soul. Until this very day, there are ex-veterans from Iraq who commit suicide because they are still damaged in the soul because of what they went through in Iraq. I'm not sure that any state should pay such a price in order to resuscitate a dead body politic, name Iraq. And I'm not talking about the money. The money is cheap. Blood is much more meaningful. Blood of people who came back in coffins, and blood of those who lost organs, and their mind maybe as well, which is another organ. So this is not the way how to keep a state. By sending troops from another country to get killed, or injured, or mentally damaged. I don't think this is the way how to keep a country. With all respect to the Americans. Syria should have been divided 6 years ago by the United Nations and by force. And Assad should be kicked out and maybe become the emir of the Alawis, who occupy like 5% of the country in the coastal area, and then he should be the leader of the Alawis, Why should he be the ruler of the Sunnis? Why did he? Because the French looked for a mercenary to do an order in Syria when they were there in the 30s, and they empowered the Alawis. Why? Why should today states will preserve the interests of the colonialists from dozens of years ago? Extremists, you might mean terrorists, like yeah. Jihadists. Wherever a clan rules the place, they kick out the jihadists. Because the jihadists want to undermine the pyramid of the clan. They want to establish a different kind of entity led by Islam, while the tribe actually works according to rules, which are in some cases against Islam. But for them, it is really much more important.
So if the U.S. were to leave Iraq, the tribes, in the Sunni tribes are strong enough to defeat the terrorists and prevent them
from... Well, every tribe should have its own emirate. And Haifa, it's a snake with diamonds. Look, it comes also to the Palestinians, because when I talk about the ideal solution between Israel and Palestinians, this is the solution. Emirates, you can find it in this website, which I dedicated to, www.palestinianemirates.com. An emirate in Gaza, and Gaza, as you know, is already a state for 10 years. In June, it will be 10 years under Hamas. They have a normal government, accepted legitimate government, and the prime minister, and an army, and a police, and judicial system, and ministry of health, and ministry of education, and borders, and agreements with their neighbors. Look, they have agreements with Israel. Israel feeds them. Although they call, you know, to eradicate Israel altogether, Israel sends every single day 900 trucks loaded with food to the Hamas in Gaza. This is a super state. This is not a state. It's much more powerful than Israel. They succeeded to force us to feed them, to drench them, to give them oil, to give them electricity. And when a woman has problems giving birth in Gaza, she's brought to Israel, and we actually are in charge of her birth. Okay? This is a super state. So definitely Gaza is a state, and the Hamas in Gaza will never become part of the Palestinian state because they have already their own state. Israel can continue and establishing an emirate for the clans of Hebron, the Jabri and the Kawasmi, Nachi, all these clans of Hebron who live nicely and peacefully together. Another emirate in Jericho for the Arikats, because they don't get married with each other. Ramallah for the Barghoutis and the Tawis. In Nablus for the Masri, Tukan, and Shaka, and every one of them has their own leader, a real leader, not politicians. I can give you the names of all these leaders. And one in Turkana for the Karmis, so forth in Kalkila and Jenin, while Israel should forever remain in the rural areas, this is Jerusalem, and offer Israeli citizenship to the villagers, while all the citizens of the emirates can be independent from Israel. This will give them stability and to Israel security. This is the only solution which is connected to sociology and not to dreams from who come from Europe about non-existent peoples which do not exist in the Middle East.
What is the website that you mentioned?
www.palestinianemirates.com. Yes. This is like 90% of the population will be given independence. Now, this is the architecture. Now you can engineer the roads, the water supply, how they get to the harbors, how they get to Ben Gurion Airport. I sat with the king of Hebron, and he began saying, okay, I get it. Do you give me Terminal 1 in Ben Gurion Airport? It's a terminal which we don't use. Why is it not used? Well, once it, why not? Israel uses Terminal 3. Okay, well, where is the problem? He wants a part of Ashdod Harbor. What is the problem? Let him live it. Okay? Everything is about technical solutions. The PA should be dismantled and should vanish because it is no role. It's unacceptable, illegitimate, just like the regime in Syria, Iraq, and Libya. Iran also is an artificial state. There is no Iranian nation, for those who really know the reality. In Iran, Iran is highly fragmented to ethnicities, which again cannot correspond with each other. I'll show you This is one of the maps of Iran. There's different colors. I'll be now. Turkmens, Gilakis, Mazandaranis, Talishis, Persians, Azeris, Kurds, Arabs, Loris, Baluchis, Kashkais. How many of them are familiar to the American people? Okay? Iran is an artificial state made by Britain. And its fate is one day to fall apart. It will happen. A year, 5, 10 years, 20 years from today. I have no idea when. And what will be the cause? But don't forget that Baluchistan actually is Sunni, while the Persians are Shia. Also, the Kurds who live here are also Sunnis. And there is a constant war, which nobody knows about, between the Baluchis and the government, and between the Kurds and the government. Almost every day, there are attacks of the local Baluchis here and the Kurds here against convoys, against vehicles, against tanks, against carriers of the government in those regions. But journalists are not allowed to be there. So nobody knows about those wars inside Iran. Okay? So Iran one day will also fall apart according to ethnic lines. I have absolutely no doubt. Thank you very much.